God bless you, and what a joy to be with you today. Thanks for spending this time, our beautiful online family, and listening live on Sirius XM. It's another day the Lord has made, and the service is better because you joined us today.
That is the truth. I love that. It's better because you showed up. You have to know that we pray for you, and we believe that God's got so many blessings in store for you and your family. Enjoy the service.
This is a new day. I'm calling out the mighty hero. The forces that are for you are greater than any force that's trying to stop you.
And we believe today, God, that you will do what only you can do.
He calls you a barrier breaker, a prized possession. Welcome to Lakewood today. Thanks so much for coming out. How many of you are ready to worship the Lord today? God's been good to us all and brought us through another week, and always blessed to have you come out in person, and of course our online family as well, and people listening live on Sirius XM. I think it's one of our prayers every week is, God, don't let any of us leave the same way we came in here. I believe you're going to go out of here with more joy and more faith and more victory today. So thanks for being a part. I think there's one thing that we have to do to receive the new. You have to get rid of the old. And by old, I mean, you know, negativity, discouragement, what didn't work out last week. The enemy would love for us to just, you know, stay in that negative frame of mind. If you'll empty all that out, God will fill you again today with fresh peace and fresh joy and fresh strength. And that's what we're praying for each one of you. But thanks for coming out. We love you guys very much. We take the first half hour to sing praises and to thank God for what He's done. You know, I sometimes think, well, Joel, I'm waiting for the main part of the service, but this can be the main part of the service as we, you know, when I was a little boy, they used to say, as the praises go up, blessings will come back down. So if you want to receive from God today, the first thing is let's just enter with praise and thanksgiving. You know, we can all think about what's wrong, but how about we think about the fact that we're alive and we woke up this morning. We have friends and family. We're able to be here together. Let's have that grateful attitude. And I believe, like I just prayed and declared, that you're going to leave better than you came. But thanks so much. We love you guys and we appreciate you being with us today.
Yes, that is so good. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. We love having you here today. You know, the scripture says that whatever's weighing us down, it's up to us to release that weight. You know, it's easy to let things just pile on top of you, but we have to learn to release the weight of all these burdens that try to come on us each and every day. And you know, there's always a part that we have to play. We always have a part. We're partners with Jesus Christ. We're in partnership. So that means we have to do something and he'll do what he promised he's gonna do. So it's like we do what we can do and God will do what we can't do. And I know there's so many of you here today that are like, you know what? I need God to do what I can't do. Well, believe today that he can and that he will do what you can't do. You do what you can do and let him do what you can't do. I was texting a friend of mine early this morning when I was getting dressed, and I just had her on my heart. She came to my mind, and I know that she's going through a super difficult season, not only in her personal life, but in her professional life. It's like it's all intermingled, and it's something that she didn't see coming. She would have never wanted. And she came up in my heart, and I had told her I was going to be praying for her. And so I texted her this morning, and I said, I want you to know that I'm thinking of you, and I'm praying for you. And you are strong in the Lord. You are full of his wisdom. You are full of favor. And I just said, and I want you to know Houston, Texas is praying for you. And so I put my phone down and I kept getting dressed for the early service this morning. And when I was leaving, I look at my phone and she says, Victoria, I can't believe that you thought about me and are praying for me this morning. She said, the enemy has stole it all, but he'll never steal my hallelujah. He'll never steal my praise. And that so inspired me this morning. Man, it made me want to put my heels in deeper and say, that's right. You know what? The enemy, circumstances, seasons of life are not going to steal our praise because we serve a mighty God and he is for us. He will do the impossible as we serve him, as we honor him, as we give him praise. He says he'll inhabit that praise. So this morning, you may feel like my friend, and I want you to know, dig your heels in deep. This is your time. This is your moment. God wants to get in your praise. He wants to be in everything that you're doing, in every circumstance and in every season. We serve a good God. So let's keep our eyes on him. Let's keep our praises coming out of our mouth and watch God turn things around. Amen? Amen. Let's enter in with thanksgiving and praise. Father, we thank you for this day that we can gather together, Lord, that we can join our faith. We are stronger in this place, Father. So we thank you for what you're going to do in this place as we praise you, as we worship you, as we put you on your rightful throne of our life. We thank you that you can do anything but fail us this morning. So we come with a grateful heart, a heart of praise and a heart of thanksgiving, looking at what's right and not at what's wrong. Looking at you for our future. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said,
amen.
Yes.
There's a joy that overwhelms our souls. Cause we know our God is in control of love. Let your favor pour out, Jesus. Somebody help me say,
the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. and praise on the mountain. I praise when I'm sure and praise when I'm doubting. Oh, I praise when I'm numbered. I praise when surrounded. His praise is the waters my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. Oh, I got a praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. I praise when I feel it. I praise when I know. Yes, I will. I praise because I know you're still.
Today, we believe there are greater things. of Jesus. The Bible says that at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow and tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of all, to the glory of God the Father. Jesus is the highest name. Jesus is the greatest name. Jesus is the most powerful name. Jesus is the name that every knee bows to. We lift up the name of Jesus. Come on, can we sing this together, church? I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt thee.
Thank you. do whatever you want to. Nothing's impossible for you. Bring down the heavens here on the hill.
You've done in our lives. Lord, we know we're not here by accident, but you handpicked each one of us to be here. Lord, we thank you that you chose us before we could choose you. And as we start off this new week, Lord, we say it publicly that you're our Lord, our God, and our Savior. Lord, make us, mold us into who you want us to be. And Lord, I thank you even now as we're worshiping you that you're strengthening your people and Lord, filling us afresh and anew with your spirit, with your love, with peace and joy. Lord, I thank you that every force that's trying to stop us has been broken in the name of Jesus. Depression, anxiety, addictions, sicknesses, trouble at work, at home, in our finances. Lord, I thank you today is a breakthrough day, that you're doing what only you can do. Lord, our eyes are upon you today. We may have some big challenges, but we know you're a big God, that you've got us all in the palm of your hand. Lord, that you being for us is more than those that are against us. And so Lord, today we come back to a place of peace. Our trust is in you, Lord. We thank you that you have not brought any of us this far to leave us where we are. But even right now, Lord, I thank you that you're going before us, making crooked places straight, opening right doors, and closing wrong doors, bringing the right people across our path and weeding out those that should not be there. Lord, I thank you that we have the mind of Christ, a spirit of wisdom and discernment, that our spiritual ears and eyes are open, sensitive, and responsive to your voice. Lord, I thank you that we know the right decisions, decisions that will move us toward our God-given destiny. Father, I thank you we will not be at this same place next year as we are right now, but we are moving forward, stepping into new levels of our destiny. Lord, I thank you that you're taking us where we can't go on our own. Lord, we enlarge our vision today. We take the limits off of you, Lord God. I thank you for 2024, not a get by, make it through year, but a favor-filled year, a blessed year, a productive year. Lord, doing what only you can do. Lord, you've done it in the past, but we believe the best is still in front of us in Jesus' name. Lord, I do pray for those as well that are fighting battles in their health, those that are watching, listening, some from the hospitals. Lord, I thank you right now that healing and wholeness is flowing into all those that need it. Lord, we know you can even do what medicine cannot do, that you have the final say. So Lord, I speak victory into your people. I think that the tide of that battle is turning, that no sickness can stay in our bodies, for we are temples of the Most High God. Lord, I thank you even now, your strength and energy and healing is flowing into each one of us, renewing our youth, that we will run and not be weary in Jesus' name. And Lord, I do lift up those as well that are in tough times, those that have gone through loss. Father, you said you're close to the brokenhearted. Let them feel your presence right now like they've never felt. Peace that passes understanding. Lord, I thank you for comforting them, that even though it can feel like it's the end, that you have a new beginning. You said weeping endures for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. So Lord, I just speak fresh vision, fresh anointing, fresh favor, fresh relationship, new beginnings into your people. Lord, you've done great things in the past, but we believe and declare that the best is still in front of us. Lord, that we are victors and never victims in Jesus' name. And if you receive it, can you say amen today? One way we release our faith is through our words. And so every service, we like to make this declaration. This is what God says about us. So when we say it today, just know that it's sinking deeper down in your spirit. Even though sometimes you say it and you think, well, that's not really true for me. Let me tell you, it's on the way. You just keep declaring it, keep believing. God is faithful. Come on, say it like you mean it. I am blessed, prosperous, redeemed, forgiven, healthy, whole, talented, creative, confident, secure, disciplined, focused, prepared, qualified, motivated, valuable, free, determined, equipped, empowered, anointed, accepted, and approved. Not average, not mediocre. I am a child of the Most High God. I will become all I was created to be in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. My father always taught us that you will never rise any higher than the way you see yourself. That's why I like to make that declaration every service, because, you know, life tries to put different labels on us, like, you know, not that talented or too many mistakes, or we can all come up with some negative things, but it's so important just all through the day, just tune all that out and say, God, I know I am who you say I am. Listen, God has the final say. My encouragement, my challenge is start seeing yourself rising higher. See yourself accomplishing your dreams. You know, you may have some children that are off course. Why don't you see them serving God, fulfilling their purpose? You know, you may not feel healthy and whole. It's easy to look at the medical report. And, you know, we respect what medical science does, but let me tell you, God can do what medicine cannot do. God has the final say. So, you know, these days it's easy. Let me Google all these things and you can get depressed Googling, you know, one symptom. But how about you go back, God, I think that you're my healer. You said with long life you would satisfy me. Let's get in agreement with what God says. Let me give you a couple scriptures. The path of the righteous gets brighter and brighter. Well, Joe, I don't know. I think I'm going the wrong way. Well, let's get a different vision. Lord, I think that my best days are still in front of me. Well, I'm just hoping to get by in 2024, Joe. No, not me. 2024 is going to be a favor-filled year, a blessed year, a productive year, a healthy year. Let me tell you who I'm looking at today. I'm looking at children of the Most High God. Not average people. I'm looking at people who are equipped, people who are empowered, people who are healthy and strong, people who are valuable and talented, people who have the favor of God on their lives. I love that in Psalms it says that God has crowned us with favor. Sometimes I think it's important just, you know, you got to do it by faith, by your imagination. You just got to straighten that crown of favor. That's just saying, you know what? I'm not looking at average people. I'm looking at favored people. God handpicked you. One more thought and I'll quit, y'all, but it keeps coming. I got to keep going, but here's one more. You know, you think about in the scripture, when God created the heavens and the earth, he said that was good. created the mountains, that was good. Created the fish, that was good. But when he created Adam and Eve, he said, that was very good. Only thing God said was very good was you and me. You know, yeah, the Rocky Mountains, that's pretty spectacular, but God calls you the masterpiece. God calls you highly favored. God crowned you with favor. So let's carry ourselves like children of the Most High, knowing that we're equipped and empowered. Let me tell you, 2024 is going to be a year you see God show out in your life and do some unusual, uncommon things, things that you couldn't make happen. It's on the way, in Jesus' name. Well, we'll take a moment to pray today for all of you here in the auditorium. If you need prayer, there'll be a prayer partner at the front or the back of your section. Anyone's welcome to come for prayer during this next song. We'll stand in agreement with you. And rest of you, you're welcome to be seated if you'd like. We'll take a moment to pray. And a beautiful wife, Victoria, is going to pray for you, our online family, and listening on Sirius XM. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you for joining us today. We are so glad that you're here. We want to stand in agreement with you for what you need God to do in your life. This is a time that we pray. Prayer is going on right now in the auditorium. We have prayer partners agreeing with them. And so we want you to know we love you and we care about you, and we want to agree with you in prayer. So put your prayer requests in the chat, because that's just an act of faith. It's saying, God, I believe that you can do what only you can do. And so today, as you are putting those prayer requests in the chat, I want to remind you of a scripture that says the prayer of the righteous produces wonderful results. And today, if you're coming to God and you're in right standing with him and you know who he is in your life, he hears your prayers. He is listening to your requests. And the scripture says he even bends down to hear your prayers. So know he's a God who loves us and cares for us, and he wants to hear what's on your heart. So prayer brings God closer to us because we bring him closer to our situation. And so today, know that God loves you so much, and put those prayer requests in and believe that God is going to answer you. And don't ever give up in prayer, because he's always present. Even when he feels like he's distant, you have to believe that he is present. You know, the Bible says that the life of a believer is to believe. And I think living on this earth, that is one of our main jobs, is to fight back discouragement and doubt and keep our faith stirred up to believe and trust that God has good things in store for us. I want to read a couple of prayer requests that have already come in. We have Shane, and he is asking to be healed from a rare form of cancer. So Shane, we stand with you, and we believe that by the stripes of Jesus, you are healed. And I just pray that the angels of the Lord would encamp around you, Shane, and any others who have a battle that seems bigger than anything else, a battle that you don't know how is going to come to the end, how it's going to come out. But I want you to know that God has got you in the palm of his hand. So continue to trust him and believe him. We have Brenda for her 2-year-old grandson undergoing his 5th open heart surgery. And so, man, a grandmother, mother, a family member who has to watch a 5-year-old go through that, it's got to be so difficult. So we're standing with you that not only you will have strength, but that you will be able to speak the word of God into his life and into the family's life. And so we're standing with you that 5-year-old, this is going to be the end of that surgery, the final surgery, and he is ever with whole. We have mental illness, Michael, for his daughter struggling with depression and anxiety. We just bind every evil force that would try to come against our children and our adult life with anxiety and depression. We stand against that. Pat, to be healthy mentally, to step into better opportunities. And so, you know, I believe you have the mind of Christ Jesus. That's what the scripture says, that you have the mind of Christ. And that's why putting God's word in you will help you think the thoughts of God. And, you know, putting his word in you isn't a struggle. It's just sitting down, reading the Bible, not not saying I gotta consume. You don't consume, you know, breakfast, lunch, and dinner all at the same time. You do it little by little throughout the day. So maybe you find a scripture, and throughout the day, you meditate on that scripture. You have something when those doubtful thoughts, when those anxious thoughts, those crushing thoughts try to come against you. You know, I always say to erase the thought, you have to replace it. So you can't just leave your mind empty, but replace it with a scripture, something that God says about you, that you're more than a conqueror, that you're dearly loved. So today we're praying for all those who have anxiety and depression, or for your children who have anxiety and depression. We have families that need to be reconciled together. We know that God is the mender of all hearts. He's the reconciler. He reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. So why wouldn't he want our families to be reconciled? But right now, whatever it is you need, I just want you to give it to God. Just put it on the throne of his throne. And just say, God, I'm giving you this. I'm surrendering it to you right now. And so I'm going to agree with you that God will come in and do what only he can do, that he'll turn that situation around in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that my brother, my sister, everyone at the sound of my voice, I believe, Father, that they have faith right now, that faith is rising in their heart, and the doubt and discouragement, depression, anxiety has to go in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, come in and do your work. Do what you do best, and that is comforting us, strengthening us, helping us, healing us. I speak healing to body and soul and mind right now in Jesus' name. I speak healing to relationships, reconciliation. Father, I speak financial breakthroughs, salvation to family members. Father, I thank you that cancers have to go in Jesus' name. They have to go in the name of Jesus. They're on foreign territory. I thank you, Father, that our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and anything that's coming against it right now cannot stay. And I declare that to be in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for everything that you are doing in the lives of your people, in the lives of those who are watching right now. Those are your people, Father. We thank you for what you're doing in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. We love you guys. God bless.
First Corinthians chapter 12 the whole chapter is a phenomenal chapter, and it really shows us and tells us that the body, God uses the body to describe and to help us to understand how our lives work together as the church. Each part of the church, significant, has a critical part to play in the big picture. Whether the part is seen or unseen, whether the part is mentioned or the part isn't mentioned, the reality is each part is significant, right? Now, this whole chapter, really what it's saying, if you could summarize the whole chapter in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it really is saying this to the believer. Alone, you're purposeful, you're powerful, but when you find your place in the body of Christ, when you connect, that is when you really discover your full potential. It's when you find your significant place in the body of Christ, when you realize I am one member of a larger body and I have a part to play in that. I have some Legos here that I brought from my 13-year-old son. And these Legos are actually pretty cool. I don't know if we have any Lego fans here or watching online, but you know, I mean, adults now, we're all putting together Legos. It's a good, I mean, you gotta appreciate, I mean, how these things look and how they're built. I mean, this Ferrari, I mean, look at the details on this Ferrari. I mean, you got the way these doors open, the blue interior, you got the engine in the back. You may not be a Lego fan, but you got to appreciate the engineering of these Legos. I mean, we got the Bugatti here. I mean, that's a nice car, right? That's a nice looking vehicle, but these techniques, look at the Lamborghini here too. You gotta look at the Lamborghini and you know, I mean, all the doors, how it just slides open. I don't know if we, oh, look at that, look at that, look at that. I mean, look at the brake calipers in the wheels. I mean, there's so much, these These Lego Technics are made up of thousands of little pieces. And yours truly has stepped on a lot of these pieces as I've walked around the house. But when my son Denver, when he brings one of these boxes home and he opens the box and he gets really excited, this is what he starts with. Thousands of little pieces, individual pieces, right? And he then opens the instruction manual because the designer has a master plan on how each part is going to connect to one another to build something pretty incredible, pretty fascinating, right? Now, Denver spends days and weeks meticulously connecting piece after piece after piece. Now, alone, these pieces, I mean, they're cool, but alone, they're parts, right? It's when you take the parts and you line them up with the instruction manual and you piece them together, you connect them, that is when the parts come alive to be a part of something bigger and greater. Oh, I believe you're already ahead of me, church. You are a significant part of a bigger picture. And when we connect to one another, we build something pretty incredible for the world to see. We become a part of something bigger than ourselves. When we connect our part to an existing part next to us or somewhere within the body of Christ, we realize, wow, we're better together. We're stronger together. We're purpose-driven. We can be a part of something that is changing the world. So right now, because you're here and you're tuning in online, can you just clap for yourselves because you are a part of a moving body, the body of Christ, connecting and bringing hope to the world. I have some friends who I think can really illustrate what I am trying to convey today, and they can go ahead and come up because their stories are testimonies to the principle of connection. And they all have different ways and walks of life that they're coming from. They all have a unique experience. And I thought it'd be pretty cool for us to just hear a little snippet of each of their journey and how the power of connection has changed their lives. So I'm here first with my friend Fernanda. And Fernanda has a phenomenal story of connection. Fernanda, where are you from? And how has this principle of connection changed your life? What's it look like for you?
So I'm from Brazil, and in 2009, life just changed, and connecting with people just made a huge difference. I met Pastor Joe online after a big breakup, and then in 2011, while I was in Brazil, I was able to watch through Facebook and YouTube, but then it was not until 2021 when COVID hits and my brother passed, I needed to support my family emotionally. So then I look at the website and I found the life groups, and that my life just changed completely. I connected, I became a life group member, and then in 2022, I came here for the first time in person, and I served at the warehouse. Right, man? Yeah, I served at the warehouse, and it was like so amazing, and I told myself, I am going to move here, and I'm going to serve, and I'm going to give it back what has been giving it to me. So in June 23, I moved here. I served the Hope and Life, and then I become a greeter in August. I became a life group leader in Portuguese, and the very first life group in Portuguese of the history of Lakewood.
Wow.
And
I got it. Can you greet the church in Portuguese? Can you do that real
yes.
quick?
Oi, gente, aqui do Brasil, olá, gente. Se vocês quiserem participar do Life Group, vem.
We got some Brazilian family
yes.
here.
Obrigada, gente.
Watching online gente. As well.
And so serving makes a difference. And then now the next big step of my life is being baptized in April. So
wow.
This is just like the best
wow.
thing. And then one more thing is, I just moved to a new place and my house was furnished by the help of my community.
Wow.
I didn't have to buy one single thing. I got everything donated.
Wow, the generous
people
of Lakewood.
Yes.
How cool is that? I mean, watching online, like thousands are right now, and you connected to an online life group, and then you're like, I gotta move to H-Town. I gotta come to Houston. It's much better in person, isn't it, church family? I mean, it is, And now you're leading,
leading
a life group in Portuguese.
Life group in Portuguese,
phenomenal.
And it makes a difference when you can give it back to the community.
Yes.
So I'm ready to pay it forward and keep serving and keep, you know, it's amazing.
Awesome, come on, give it up for Fernanda, what a story. All right, we got this amazing couple, this group here in the middle, Dr. William and Lois. How has connection looked like for you? Where did it start? Why did you get connected? Give us your story.
Wow, so this Lakewood community has been amazing to us, and the power of it is unspeakable. You can't put words to it. We were recently married and were, I guess, having difficulties communicating and ran into some problems there, and both of us, actually we just found this out today, had messaged to find out if there was help through the church.
Okay.
Lois had, I guess, stopped messaging after, but I was pretty persistent, so I just kept on going and sending messages. And
were you watching online or were you attending?
So we were, originally we came a couple times. We were as well between here and another church that we were going to, but right before we started messaging, we actually committed to coming here full time, and we're here probably about for 2 months or so.
Okay.
And then when we realized and we heard Pastor Joel speak about the marriage ministry and all of that, we were like, well, there has to be something for us that could help us. So we sent the message, and, you know, this, again, powerful community here. We were able to get in contact with Jesse and Marla, who have originally started off as our mentors, but then became to us our family. We now call them our bonus parents.
Wow.
And
that's awesome.
They continue to provide judgment-free advice to us and frequently just lend a listening ear to us, which has been amazing. It's also allowed us to have some guidance and to really reassure kind of our relationship with God and kind of remind us about our walk with God, as well as it provided us with just, again, a family, an extended family now, that our children have now grown to call them Mimi and Poppy. So it's been a great...
So it's
great...
Mimi and this is Poppy.
Yes,
here. Okay.
Yes, all Mimi,
right.
And Poppy.
Big
so.
Poppy.
So it's been a blessing. Again, it's something that we never dreamed of, but we are so blessed to have them in our lives and be a part of this wonderful...
Awesome. What a family, what a story. Watching, coming, getting plugged into our marriage classes. Let me just brag on Jesse and Marla too. I think that's powerful when you have people in their faith who are further down the track, willing to spend time, go out to coffee and invest in younger married couples to give them wisdom, to give them advice and guidance. Credit to you guys, it's absolutely phenomenal. But that's what the local church does. When parts connect, we can strengthen each other. Phenomenal story. All right, last, Shauna, Jesse, the whole crew here. How have you guys seen the power of connection look in your life? How has it helped you guys?
We started coming here in 2008 as a family, and we decided that this was a place where the worship and the word would minister to each and every one of us.
Yeah.
And so we talked it over, prayed about it, said, we're gonna go. We're bringing our family. You know, we live in the Woodlands area, so we said the distance isn't going to intimidate us.
Yes.
The size of the church isn't going to intimidate us. We're going to come. We're going to plug them in. So we were here for Monday night Bible study. We brought the kids with us. We were here for Wednesday night, for youth, for kids' life. They came with us to marriage class. We've all attended a life group. You know, they've done youth and young adult life groups. And Jesse and I started volunteering, so we wanted the kids to also get involved and volunteer. So Yasmin started volunteering in Champions, and then Jaden and Jonas would attend financial class because they were in high school, so they would go up there without us, and I think they learned a lot from that. But eventually they started serving in Kids Life, and so we're all planted, and we've all got our connections, and we've got our friends, and
wow.
So it's been a blessing.
That's amazing. Yeah. A family that's flourishing in their
yes.
faith. I love because mom and dad found a place of connection for their children. And I just think that that's a powerful component of the local church, is spaces for the next generation to grow in their faith. So we commend you guys and the students and my guy for connecting and growing in your faith. Church, can we celebrate these stories of connection and what we've seen God do? It's all of us. It's all of us, really, parts connecting. And like I said, I think many of us could be one connection away from unlocking our full potential. Maybe you're here today and you're not connecting. You're a part, but maybe you find yourself not as engaged as you'd like to be. Maybe today is a day where you allow some stories and testimonies inspire you to be connected. You know, my son, when he's putting together these Legos, there have been countless times where I'll hear him shout from his bedroom, "Dad, I can't find a piece." And I gotta run upstairs, and we're frantic, searching in the piles of Legos, looking on the ground for one lost piece. Why? Because each part matters when you put together these Legos. Each part is significant. And I believe that's the heart of God today, is that He is searching for those who are disconnected, and He's saying, come be a part of the body. Be a part of the greater good. I have a specific plan and purpose for you. And when you connect, you will begin to see God show out in new levels in your life. If you believe that today, church, can you say amen? Amen. God bless you this morning.
We are so blessed to have you. You make us stronger. We are better together. Well, thanks for being here. We'll take a moment to worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. We always want to thank you for your generosity and your donations. Together, we're making an impact all over the world. I love what it says in Proverbs 11. It says, the generous prosper and are satisfied. That's our declaration for each one of you, because I know you're generous with your time, with your talent, with your efforts, with your money as well. I just believe that you're going to see God do some unusual things in your life that, you know, to be satisfied, Victoria, it means that, you know, you're not lacking. You know, you have the funds to send your kids to college. You have the peace in your mind. You have the joy in your spirit. That's what we believe for each one of you, because you keep God first place. And let's remember to release our faith in our finances. Our job is not our source. God is our source. He sees you being faithful. You keep doing the right thing. And let me tell you, I believe blessings, abundance, overflow is headed your way. 2024, not a get-by year, but a favor-filled year for you and your family.
Dr. Philip is a medical doctor, and he and his wife, Lally, live and work in Bihar, India. Bihar is known as the graveyard of missions because it's so difficult to work there. Less than 1% of the population is Christian. There are 486 different people groups in Bihar, and 459 of them are considered unreached, meaning they have little access to the gospel. Dr. Philip and his team are making a difference in Bihar. They have 600 staff missionaries reaching out to unreached people groups. Over 200 churches have been started by the alumni of their Bible school. 3,000 children are currently enrolled in their schools, and they have 20 homes established to raise and care for orphaned or indigent children. Dr. Philip is also the director of Christian Medical Center, a hospital caring for the neediest people in Bihar. Our families have been connected since 1987, when Dr. Philip's late father hosted my parents when my dad was holding a large crusade in South India. We're so honored to be able to partner with Dr. Philip to reach the people of Bihar, India.
I'd like to thank Lakewood Church for your generous support. I'd like to thank you for the legacy that is here. Mm. And your prayers and your encouragement and your support from the time of my father, even continuing on to the next generation. Mm. Thank you for your prayers. And thank you, Pastor Joel, Pastor Victoria, Dr. Paul, Jennifer, and all the team members here who make our work stronger and more effective for the sake of the gospel. God bless you all.
Thank you, Lakewood, for your generous support that allows us to partner with people like Dr. Philip to reach men and women and children in difficult areas of the world with the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
I love that you are willing to invest in people that you have never seen or met, people that are hurting and are in need, and you're willing to share what God gave you with them. I believe that kind of investment will yield amazing returns. Know today that your giving is making a difference, not only in the lives all over the world, but it's making a difference in you and your family. We appreciate your generosity and are so grateful for the partnership that you have with this ministry.
We do love you very much. I want to speak a blessing over our offering today. Lord, thank you for all of our generous givers. Lord, we believe what you promised, that they will be satisfied, that they will prosper. Lord, I thank you even this year that you will show out in their lives. Lord, let their gifts and talents come out to the full. I thank you, Lord, that they're full of wisdom and ideas and, Lord, even inventions and, Lord, just doing what they can't do on their own. I thank you for bringing contracts and businesses. Lord, blessing them so they can be a bigger blessing. Lord, our eyes are upon you this year. We thank you for overflow, for abundance, for doing things that only you can do. And Lord, help those that are in need and struggling in their finances. I just pray for a supernatural breakthrough, that Lord, you will prosper them, show them your favor in new ways. In Jesus' name, God bless you today as you give.
Here are some ways you can give. Scan the QR code using your smartphone. Text Give Hope to 77977. Go online to lakewoodchurch.com/give. Or call us toll free at 888-567-JOEL. Your giving is changing lives in our city and all over the world.
Yeah!
I can do the impossible. Brother, I'm here. Let me stand with you. Sister, I'm near. Let me see what our faith can do. Cause when two or more are gathered, praying in Jesus' name, all the power of heaven begins to move our way. There's a
Joel. I love that. Come on, let's all stand together if you would please. You never know what you're going to get at Lakewood, right? People tell me all the time, Joel, the last time I was in the Compact Center was for the ZZ Top concert. And I heard those guitars. I thought they have nothing on us, though. But thanks for being here today. You know this, but your new week goes better because you've taken time to honor God and being in the house of the Lord. And we want you to know how honored we all are to always have you here. I really believe this, that you made the service better by being here. You know why? You brought joy with you. You brought God with you. You brought faith with you. So we just speak blessings over you and your family. Thanks for being planted in the house of the Lord. That's when the scripture says that you'll flourish. You guys know in 2 weeks it's Easter Sunday, so we're going to have a great time celebrating Easter. I say this, I don't mean it to be funny, but anybody will come to church during Easter. Heathens will come to church. So why don't you invite somebody? You invite that neighbor, that person you play Little League with, that person you work out with. I heard this statistic, and I believe it, that 90% of people who have never been to church have never been invited, but 90% who are invited will go. And so, you know, you have influence with people, and I know they'll probably tell you what they tell me. It's so big. I don't know where to park. Do I need a ticket? You may have to go pick them up and have them follow you or bring them, but you know what? Like Nick, that was so good, Pastor Nick. You know, there's something about getting connected to the body and being plugged in. Let me tell you, your life goes better when you put God first place. So that's Easter Sunday. Good Friday communion service right here. We'll all gather on Friday night if you can come. Saturday, if you have children from 1 to 3, there'll be thousands, maybe lots of Easter eggs all over the auditorium. There'll be some inflatables in the lobby, something fun for your children. Again, you can invite some families as well. A couple more things. If you've never been baptized in water, the Saturday after Easter, I would love to baptize you. Maybe you have children that have never been baptized. It'd be my honor. It's the first command of the Lord Jesus. I meet people and they say, Joel, I was baptized, you know, 40 years ago. Well, I'll rebaptize you if you want to. I'm more than happy to, but that's a great thing to do to show God that you honor Him. It's showing the death, burial, and resurrection. Last thing, this is more for people who are watching. Many of you guys have never been to a service. Well, we set April 13th and 14th as a homecoming weekend. Be a great time to have you. Victoria and I and my family will be down here on Saturday. We'd love to meet you. Take a look at the facility, meet some of our staff and team. Sunday, you can come to the service. It's going to be a great time. We'd love to have you be a part of that homecoming weekend. But you can meet some of these fine people who are in this service as well, too. We'd love to have you. But guys, thanks for being here. If you're visiting, I'd love to meet you after the service. I'll be in that lobby right back over there. But when you see yourself on the big screen, can you give our TV audience a great big Lakewood welcome? Well, God bless you. It's great to be with you today, and I hope you'll stay connected with us during the week through our daily podcast, our YouTube channel, social media, and you can come visit us in person. We'd love to have you be a part of one of our services. But I'd like to start with something funny. I heard about this elderly pastor. He was close to death. He sent word for two of his members, an IRS agent and a lawyer, to come to his house. Upon arrival, he motioned for them to sit on each side of the bed. The men were very moved that they could be with the minister in his final moments. One point, the lawyer asked, "Sir, why did you choose both of us?" The minister mustered up some strength and said, "Jesus died between two sinners. That's the way I want to go." All right, y'all, say it like you mean it. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today, I will be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess, my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, I will never be the same. I am about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same, never, 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 I'll never be the same in Jesus' name. God bless you. If you'd like to open your Bibles to Zechariah chapter 9, in verse 12, you're welcome to. Zechariah chapter 9. Most of you know we have a whole service today at 2 o'clock, all in Spanish. A great Spanish-speaking team. Love to have you come out. Monday night, we have our Bible study online. Wednesday night, the service is still online. Of course,
Wednesday night, our junior high and our high school students meet as well on the fourth floor. And Thursday night, it's the college students, like 18 to 30. So love to have you come out, because we have, you know who our young people are? The next presidents and world leaders and doctors and all kinds of awesome leaders here at Lakewood. So stay planted, stay connected with us. But great to have you today. I want to talk to you today about from trouble to double. We all face difficulties and things that are not fair. Someone walks out of a relationship, setback in our finances. We come down with an illness. A man told me how a coworker was dishonest and manipulated things, and he made this man look bad. The coworker got the promotion that he deserved. He was so upset, thinking that he had missed his chance. But God sees everything you go through. He sees who did you wrong, the bad breaks, the times you were taken advantage of. And God doesn't stop all the difficulties. He won't keep you from all the trouble. But he said in Zechariah 9, if you'll be a prisoner of hope, I will restore double back to you. When trouble comes, instead of being upset, have a new perspective. That just qualified you for double. That bad break looks like a setback, but really it's setting you up to come out with twice what you had before. Twice the joy, twice the resources, twice the influence. God never brings you out the same. He makes the enemy pay for bringing the difficulty. When you understand this principle, you won't live bitter when people do you wrong or give up on your dreams because something unfair happens. You know it's setting you up for something greater. That coworker that left you out, they thought they were hurting you. They don't realize they did you a favor. They just qualified you for double. Without that setback, you wouldn't see the blessing and favor that you're going to see. Or that door that closed, the client you lost, the friend that betrayed you. Yes, it's painful. None of us like it. But instead of living discouraged, try a new approach. Lord, I thank you that double is coming. Thank you that I'll come out better than I was before, stronger, healthier, promoted, increased. God said he'd restore double back to you, but there is a condition. If you'll be a prisoner of hope. That's an interesting analogy. A prisoner means you're captive. You can't get away from it. I should be discouraged by what I'm going through, but I still believe that God is on the throne, that he's turning things to my advantage. This sickness doesn't look good. The medical expert said I'm not going to get well, but I still believe Jehovah Rapha, the Lord my healer, is restoring health back into me. Or my child's off course, no sign of him improving, but I know as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. My children are mighty in the land. That's what it means to be a prisoner of hope. You're locked in. You can't be talked out of it. You're praising when you could be complaining. You're thanking God when you don't see any sign of it. You're talking like it's going to happen when nothing is improving. In life, you're going to be a prisoner of something. Prisoner of doubt, prisoner of shame, prisoner of discouragement. Get out of those prisons. God is looking for prisoners of hope. People that don't fall apart when trouble comes. People that keep believing, keep praising, keep expecting, knowing that the trouble is setting them up for double. Well, Joel, I don't think this is ever going to happen for me. You don't know what I've been through. The enemy would love for us to be a prisoner of doubt, thinking that we're stuck, prisoner of shame. I've made too many mistakes. That's why I'm not expecting anything good. A prisoner of bitterness. They hurt me. They walked out on me. The problem is you're in the wrong prison. God wants to pay you back. He wants to give you beauty for those ashes, make the rest of your life so rewarding that you don't think about who did you wrong. You don't focus on the pains of the past. But you have to break out of that prison of defeat, bitterness, self-pity, and become a prisoner of hope. God, I know you didn't bring me this far to leave me. I believe my latter days will be better than my former days, that this trouble is setting me up for new levels of my destiny. Maybe you had a rough childhood. Your parents weren't around. There was a lot of dysfunction. You could live bitter, thinking you're at a disadvantage. Why wasn't I raised better? That's going to limit your life. Have a new perspective. That dysfunction qualified you for double. Don't sit around negative. God has something big in your future. He's going to make up for what you didn't get. Not to just where you should have been if everything was normal and healthy, but because of that disadvantage, He's going to do twice as much. It was meant to set you back, but God is going to use it to set you up, to propel you, to favor you, to take you where you've never imagined. God wants to make you a trophy of His grace. Not just bring you out, but cause you to bloom, to blossom, to see favor, great opportunities, great relationships. Now do your part and give Him something to work with. Don't have a disadvantage mentality, have a double mentality. That's what allows God to show out in your life. The Israelites had been in captivity in Babylon for many years and not allowed to return home. They had all these disappointments and hardships. Their ancestors had been in slavery, so mistreated. Now that same spirit of defeat and disadvantage was on them. The prophet Zechariah showed up while they were prisoners of war. He said to them, "If you'll be a prisoner of hope, God will restore double back to you." Imagine the battle taking place in their mind. He's saying, "Be a prisoner of hope, but look what we've been through. Look what we're up against. There's no way we could live a blessed life, be free, have abundance." They had to make a decision. Am I going to be a prisoner of defeat, focused on all the past hurts, the disappointments, how it's never going to work out? Or am I going to believe what this prophet is saying, that God has double for this trouble, that He's about to pay us back for the unfair things that have happened? They changed their mindset from a prisoner of defeat to a prisoner of hope. They saw God take them where they never dreamed. Like the Israelites, you may have had more than your share of trouble, disappointments, and people that did you wrong. God is saying to you what He said to them, "I'm about to restore double. I'm about to pay you back with twice what should have been yours." But there is a requirement. You have to get rid of that survival mentality and have a double mentality. Instead of a prisoner of doubt, switch over to a prisoner of hope. Believe that God is working, that what's meant for harm, He's turning to your advantage, that trouble set you up to come out with twice what you had before. He said, "Oh man, look what happened to me, another disappointment. No, I know, this just set me up for double. These Babylonians, they have us in exile. They think they're holding us back. They don't realize they set us up for twice the favor, twice the resources, twice the joy." If you're struggling with anxiety, depression, thoughts will tell you it's permanent, it's never going to change. Don't believe those lies. That attack is setting you up for double. The enemy meant it to stop your purpose, to push you down your gifts, keep your personality from shining. The good news is, it's going to backfire. God's going to use it to take you further than if it had not happened. Or the door that closed in your business, that contract didn't go through, it's not setting you back, it's setting you up. God didn't allow it because He has something much bigger, much better. Double is coming. Double the resources, double the influence, double the favor. When we were trying to buy property to build a new sanctuary, we found this 100-acre tract of land right off the freeway. Seemed perfect. It's about 2 miles from our former location. And I met with the owner, and he told me the property had been for sale for 20 years, and he had never had one offer on it. I knew that God had saved that for us. He said, "Joel, you don't need to sign the contract right now. You can do your preliminary drawings while we get the paperwork drawn up." 2 months later, we went to his office to sign the contract. We had an 8 a.m. meeting. We showed up at 7:45. His secretary walked out and said, "I'm sorry, the owner sold the property last night." I couldn't believe it. He gave me his word, then sold it right out from under us. And I was so disappointed. There were no more large tracts of land. We had looked everywhere. It seemed like we were stuck. I went home and told Victoria how bad it was, how that man had done us wrong, and how there was no way we could grow. She said, "Listen here, Joel, God is still in control. He knows what he's doing. We're not going to get discouraged. We're going to trust that he has something better in store." She started preaching one of my messages. I didn't want to hear that. I wanted to be depressed. I wanted to get in that prison of self-pity. "God, where are you? This wasn't fair." Victoria was saying, "No, we're going to be prisoners of hope." 6 months later, a friend called, said the Houston Rockets basketball team was moving out of the compact center and we should try to buy it. When I heard that, something came alive on the inside. This was more than I could imagine. By the grace of God, things fell into place. And in 2003, the Houston City Council voted for us to have this building. What's significant is our old sanctuary held 8,000 people. This place holds 16,000, exactly double. That man thought he was setting us back. The truth is, he was setting us up for double. He didn't even do it of his own accord. He was a pawn in the hand of God. God on purpose closed that door. I wonder if there are things you're disappointed about now, doors that have closed, injustice. You're wondering why it happened. If you only knew what God had in store, you wouldn't be disappointed. And yes, on the surface, it can be discouraging, painful, hard to deal with. But you have to remind yourself that trouble is qualifying you for double. It's setting you up for a level of your destiny that you could have never seen if it had not happened. God said in Isaiah, the Message translation, "Because you got a double dose of trouble, your inheritance in the land will be double and your joy will go on forever." Sometimes it seems like we get a double dose of trouble. It's one thing after another. That's not how your story ends. Get ready, a double dose of blessing is coming. A double dose of favor. A double dose of health and vitality. A double dose of opportunity and influence. Get this down in your spirit, double for that trouble. "Well, Joel, you're just trying to get people's hopes up." Yes, I'm trying to convince you to become a prisoner of hope, to where you can't be talked out of it, because when you do, God says double is coming. One translation of the verse in Zechariah says, "I will repay two blessings for each of your troubles." When you're at the department store, sometimes there's a 2-for-1 sale. You buy one and get two. God says here, when you have one disappointment, I'm gonna pay you back with two blessings. When you face one setback, I'm gonna give you two promotions. When one friend walks away, I'm gonna bring you two new friends, better friends. When you face a sickness, I'm not only gonna restore your health, but I'm gonna give you greater peace, a double blessing. And the fact that God allowed the trouble is a sign that he wants to increase you, that he has something greater in store. If you'll pass the test, on the other side of that difficulty is double honor, double favor, double resources. And no, we don't like the trouble. None of us like the disappointments, the injustice, but without it, we wouldn't see the fullness of our destiny. Don't let the difficulty cause you to give up, get sour, have a new perspective. The trouble means double is in your future. This is what happened with Job. Everything was going great, life was good, then the bottom fell out. Lost his health, his family, his business. He had boils all over his body. It's very painful. And Job was a good man. The scripture says he honored God and lived with integrity. Having faith doesn't exempt us from difficulties. Just because you're having trouble doesn't mean you've done something wrong. The storms of life come to us all. The good news is nothing can happen to you without God's permission. He's in control in the good times and in the tough times. No, he doesn't stop every difficulty. He doesn't prevent every attack, but he wouldn't have allowed it if it was going to keep you from your purpose. With Job, it seemed like everything was out of control, but the fact is, Satan had to ask God if he could test Job. God set a limit as to what he could do. What I'm saying is God is not just in control of your life, he's in control of your enemies. He has a hedge of protection around you that the enemy cannot cross without God's permission. And if he's allowing a difficulty, you have to remind yourself, it's not there to defeat you, it's there to promote you. On the other side of that trouble is the double portion, greater joy, greater courage, greater influence. But the challenge is, we all want the double without the trouble. At least I do. But unfortunately, they're connected. You have to go through it to get to it. The longer I live, the more I've learned to trust God in the trouble, not fight what doesn't go my way, stay in peace when things happen that I don't understand. I recognize that God is up to something. He doesn't allow anything that's not ultimately going to work for your good. One way to stay in faith in that trouble is to keep reminding yourself that that setback is really a setup, that double is coming. Things got so bad for Job, his wife told him to just curse God and die. His friends said it was his own fault, that he was getting what he deserved. In difficulties, you have to be careful who you listen to. Don't give just anyone your ear. Some people don't have your best interests at heart. They'll judge you, condemn you, try to straighten you out, tell you everything you've done wrong. They can't even run their own life, but they're telling you how to run your life. You need to be around people that speak faith into you, people that tell you that you're coming out, that healing is on the way, that God has beauty for those ashes, and that even if it is your fault, even if you made the mess, God's mercy is bigger than your mistakes. He never gives up on you. He's the God of another chance. His arms are still open wide. He can still get you to your destiny, but you have to tune out all the accusing, condemning voices and get back in the game. The enemy would love for you to be a prisoner of guilt, prisoner of shame, prisoner of regrets. I'm washed up. Come out of that prison. You're locked up with the wrong thoughts. Try a new approach, a prisoner of hope. You're redeemed. You're forgiven. You're restored. Your future is bright. The enemy wouldn't be trying to keep you in that negative prison if he didn't know that double was coming. Yes, you may make a mess of your life, but God knows how to not only clean up the mess, but how to bring you out where nobody knows what you've been through. Your mistakes are not going to be your identity. Those negative labels people have tried to stick on you are coming off today. Your own thoughts that have tried to convince you that you've missed your chance, just sit on the sidelines, those strongholds are coming down. This is your time to break free from that negative mentality and become a prisoner of hope. God said, there's one thing I want to hold you captive. Not fear, not guilt, not doubt, not discouragement. No, get locked up with hope. Believe the trouble will give way to double. Believe that your past is forgiven. Believe that your future is bright. Believe that there are beauty for those ashes. Believe that God's favor surrounds you like a shield. After Job listened to his wife and looked around and saw all the troubles, he sat down among the ashes. He didn't think he'd ever be happy again. He said in chapter 7, I will never experience pleasure anymore. In the difficult times, the enemy loves to whisper the never lies. You'll never be happy either. You'll never get well, never meet someone, never get out of this problem. Don't believe those lies. He wouldn't be telling you that if he didn't know there was something great in front of you. A few verses later, Job said, I hate my life. He was so discouraged, he didn't want to live. He thought he was done. What's interesting is even though he had given up, God had not given up on him. God knows that we're human. that sometimes our emotions get the best of us. We feel things, and we get discouraged, and we let doubt in. We think that we're stuck. Some of the greatest people in the Bible doubted. Thomas was close to Jesus. One of his disciples, he traveled with Jesus and ate dinner and did life together. Yet when Jesus rose from the dead, Thomas said, I'm not going to believe unless I see him with my own eyes. Jesus didn't hold that against him. Thomas went on to share the good news throughout all of India. Toward the end of John the Baptist's life, John said to his disciples, go ask Jesus if he's really the Messiah. Now remember, John was the one that baptized Jesus. He was in the water when the heavens opened. He heard the voice boom out, this is my beloved son. He saw the dove land on Jesus. All these incredible signs. Yet now he's wondering, is he really the Messiah? You would think if we'd seen all that, we would believe. But God didn't hold that against him. You may have doubts. At times you feel discouragement trying to come on. That happens to us all. I'm saying, don't stay there. Don't get locked up in that mindset. Let that pass. Come back to that prisoner of hope. Our attitude should be, I'm not changing my mind. I know God is faithful. He's been too good to me not to believe. He's opened too many doors I never dreamed would open. He's brought too many divine connections. He's made too many ways when I didn't see a way. He's protected me too many times, pushed back forces of darkness, poured out blessings that I cannot contain. I've been too blessed to not believe. And sure, doubt may come. Times where we could feel discouraged, and worried. How's this going to work out? Well, I've learned to say, no thanks. I'm going to be a prisoner of hope. I've seen God do it before, and I know He'll do it again. That's what sets you up to see the double, the abundance, the greatness of our God. Sitting in those ashes, Job suddenly had a change of heart. He must have turned on Lakewood. He looked up to the heavens and said, I know my Redeemer lives. He was saying, God, I know you're still on the throne. I may not understand all this, but I trust you with my life. When we hear about Job, most of the time we think of all the suffering, the hardship. And yes, it was rough, but that's not how his story ended. The scripture says, God restored Job's fortunes and gave him twice what he had before. God could have just restored him back to normal, brought him back to the way he was. He would have been grateful. But look at how God works. Job came out with twice the cattle, twice the sheep, twice the joy, twice the influence. He got a double dose of trouble that set him up for a double dose of blessing. Could it be the trouble you're going through is really God getting you in position so he can give you double? What if Job would have known early on that this was all a setup for God to do something amazing in his life? He'd have probably handled it differently. He would have trusted God in the trouble, stayed in peace in the trouble, and kept that attitude of faith, knowing that it was all going to work out to his advantage. It would be easier if God would promise us double without the trouble. But usually there are some tests that we have to go through, difficulties and things we don't understand. That's when we prove to God what we're made of, that we're faithful in the fire, that we're calm in the chaos, that we trust in the trouble, that we praise in the problem, that we're unshakable, we're immovable, we are prisoners of hope. We know God wouldn't have allowed it if it wasn't going to work for our good. So when trouble hits, instead of having a defeated mentality, we have a double mentality. The enemy meant it for harm, but God, we believe we're coming out with twice. Increased, promoted, better than we were before. I met a young woman at the altar one Sunday. She and her husband came down for prayer. She told how she had had 7 miscarriages. Now the experts said that they would never be able to have children. All the fertility treatments hadn't worked. And I'll never forget the tears running down her beautiful face, the sadness in her voice, the pain and heartache they were feeling. She had always dreamed of being a mother. Now it didn't seem possible. And sometimes life can throw us a curve. Our dreams get shattered. There's heartache and things that can squeeze the life and joy out of us. I love how God came to heal the brokenhearted, to restore what was stolen. I told them what I'm telling you, that God sees what you're going through. And when you believe, stay in faith, He can do amazing things. This couple made the decision to be prisoners of hope. Despite what the medical report said, they believed their baby was on the way. Every day they thanked God that He was bringing them this child. 2 years later, I saw them after the service in the lobby. The woman was carrying a beautiful baby girl. The husband was carrying a baby boy. They had had twins. I saw the same tears running down her cheeks, but this time they weren't tears of sadness. They were tears of joy. When you have a double dose of trouble, get ready, a double dose of blessing is coming. Now, you may be in a difficult time today. Keep the right perspective. That trouble has qualified you for double. It's not there to set you back. It's setting you up for increase, for favor, for new levels. This is not the time to get discouraged. This is the time to be a prisoner of hope. God has not brought you this far to leave you. He sees you doing the right thing when it's hard. Like that young couple praising through the pain, keeping a good attitude when it's not fair, believing when there's no sign of things changing. Because you're locked into hope, you are passing the test. Now believe and declare what God promised you, that double is coming. Something you've never seen. Twice the joy, twice the resources, twice the influence, the double blessing in Jesus' name. And if you receive it, can you say amen? Amen. I receive it as well. Let's pray together. If you have 5 minutes, stick with me and we'll just seal it in prayer. Lord, thank you for what we've heard today. I know it falls on great ground. Faithful people here at Lakewood and so many listening and watching. And Lord, we let this take root in our spirit. Lord, we're not going to live in that prison of defeat and discouragement and guilt and shame. Lord, we're breaking free from that. Lord, we're going to come into that prison of hope, Lord. We know that you're our vindicator, that you have beauty for ashes, that your mercy is bigger than mistakes. So, Lord, we're going to live from this place of faith, this place of trust, knowing that you have us all in the palm of your hand. Lord, help us to believe. Bless your people this week. Thank you for your protection and your wisdom as they go about their work and their life and their children at school. I just speak blessings over them as well. Lord, we love you. Thank you for this opportunity to be together. With our heads bowed in prayer, just a quick question. If your heart stopped beating in the next few minutes, are you at peace with God? Do you know where you'd spend eternity? If not, I would love to pray with you. I'm not here to condemn anybody. I'm here to help you find a new beginning. I know this comes from a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. In just a moment, if you're not at peace with the Lord, or maybe you are a Christian, but you've grown cold toward God, you know you need to rededicate your life. You need a fresh new start. If that's you, in just a moment, I'm going to ask you to take a step of faith and stand right where you are, and we'll pray together. I can't think of a better time to get on the road to victory than right now. God is not mad at you. Your sins have already been forgiven. All you have to do is accept the free gift of Christ's salvation. Will you do it today? The enemy in your thoughts will whisper, do it next week. Do it another time. Listen, the Bible says, today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. It's so easy. Well, Joel, it's embarrassing to stand in front of everyone. I have people at the house. I can't lift my hand. Listen to what Jesus said. If you won't be ashamed of me before people, then I won't be ashamed of you before my Father in heaven.
I'm going to give you a great opportunity to show God that you're not ashamed of Him. If you're not at peace with the Lord, or you just need to rededicate your life, you need a fresh new start, a new beginning. If that's you, would you be bold, take that step of faith, and stand right where you are, and we'll pray together. Would you do that? Come on, Lakewood, let's give them a hand as they stand all over the building. Come on, don't put it off. I feel like there ought to be a few others. Anybody else? Your heart's beating fast? That's God drawing you up top. How about watching and listening? Anybody else? Still time for you? Well, God bless you. And please remain standing if you don't mind. Let me tell you how proud we are of you. I know that took courage to stand. More importantly, I know God will never be ashamed of you because you took this step of faith today. The scripture says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Let me help you to call. Do you mind all praying this after me, if you would, please? Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. Come into my heart. I make you my Lord and Savior. Amen. I remain standing one moment. I want to tell you how much we love you and again, how proud we are of you. We're going to be praying for you. I also want to give you a personal invitation and a challenge to come back and be with us on a regular basis. We ask new believers to give us a year, the next year of your life. Like you heard a little earlier, make a commitment for the next year that you're going to be here every time you can, in person, online, on the radio, however you do it. I'll make a promise before that year is over, your life will never be the same for the better. And I know on Sundays, it's probably a day off, you're busy, you could run errands, but can I tell you, there is a blessing on your life when you put God first place and get into a community of faith, and even like we're talking about, getting connected. Love to have you here at Lakewood. If you can't go somewhere good, but we'd love to have you here. I hope you'll take me up on that offer. Hey, after service, there's a room called New Beginnings if you need anything. It's right out here. Stop by, meet some friends, information. There's classes after service. There's things online as well. We want to really help you to grow. But know this, the moment you stood up, God washed away all your sins, your mistakes, your failures. You are starting with a fresh, clean slate. Write it down in your Bible, March 17th, 2024, a new day of victory in your life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, let's all stand together, if you would, please. Thanks so much for coming out today. How many of you are going home better off than you were before? Amen. Well, we love you guys very much. I'm going to speak a blessing over you. Until we meet again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord show you His favor and have mercy on you. And may the Lord watch over you and give you His peace. God bless you. Have an awesome week, a favor-filled week, and we'll see you back real soon.